Anyway, because the first topic that I want to cover is how can we keep using security.debian.org for Wizzy LTS still prospered, which involves while somehow transitioning the rights from the security team over to the LTS team when the support period ends, and without any FTP master to discuss this, it's a bit useless. So maybe we will first start with another topic. Second topic is what do we want to support and what can we afford to support for Wizzy LTS? Do we want, on two levels, do we want to support more architectures because we're currently supporting only AMD 64, E3 86? And what about the list of interpreted packages? Because it would be really nice if it could be much shorter. This is supposed to be a bot, so not only me speaking, so I will ask you your input, and I hope we will have input from security team members. I'll ask that. So we have our FTP master. You alone? So maybe we can go back to the first topic, because I expect the second topic will take more time.
Is that all the topics we have?
This core question is what I have written down, but if you have other topics to add, sure, we can add some more. So,
Then there's another topic then what to do if the issue is not fixed and stable.
Yeah, it's part of the missed question.
But the missed question is not fixed and unstable. But there's also the situation that packages are not fixed and stable.
Yeah, alright. But usually it's
related, yeah. Similar.
Related to
answer.
So,
I would like to add another question, but I'm not sure if this is on topic. And the question is, are we going to do an LTS for every release?
Right.
For example, or are we going to like skip releases because it will be like more and more support effort? And
right.
I know that there are problems with skipping releases. Just the question is this this for or just something else?
So the
current
because support time frame, there shouldn't be much overlap. I mean, if it's 2 years, you essentially have an overlap of a couple of months at most. So that's, if you would skip it, you would leave it in the world. So that don't
yeah.
think that's possible.
So it fits very well. So you have no. There's no point in skipping a release. The way it's organized means we roughly support every release for 5 years, 2.5 by the security team and 2.5 by the LTS team. So it matches well.
And I think we can say that we will do LTS for future releases. Like till now, LTS was an experiment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we can declare this experiment a success and that we continue doing LTS forever.
Yeah, I think that's an important point, actually.
That's what we already announced, sort of, because rather explicit in the Jesse release announcement that it would benefit from LTS as well, because up to now LTS has been sort of working relatively well. So maybe Ansgar, it's your turn to start, and then or Maurice, I don't know. How can we handle this? This usage of security.debian.org by the LTS team.
So I think what we want is basically has to squeeze LTS suit on security.debian.org instead of.
No, basically we want no station suit. We want to keep using the suite the security team is using, so that the users do not have anything to change in their source list. And currently, the policy on Swiss LTS is rather freeform, but this is something that we could change. I mean, right now, Swiss LTS is open to any DDDM. There's no proposed update in front of it. There's no queue in front of it. While there are queue in the case of security repository. But Yeah. From my point of view, although my React, it's okay. It's okay if you keep this queue and have to handle the burden of validating or accepting the package that are uploaded. So, because we have people sort of in charge for front desk work that could be in charge of accepting new equals. Doesn't need to change everything, but at least to hand over access rights.
Yeah, that's probably possible, but so if you get a lock-in on Security Master, you can see...
Can you just check it?
No, because
it's easy and I got the image. Maybe I should go on the other side and someone else to...
So, one of the things we have Security Master on an extra host is because there are these embargo issues. I don't know if the LTS team is supposed to see them while they are still being embargoed, but there are various ways to see them if you are on Security Master. So that's basically something we need to ask the security team for. Then having a suit without any policy queue is fairly simple. So that's like Squeeze LTS currently works. A bit of a not nice part is that you currently have the unsupported architectures that are present as well. And if you support only AMD64 and i386, then the packages get out of sync between architectures, which is a bit confusing.
Can you stop a moment so Rafael can take notes? Because you had the third topic right now and he's at the first. And I forgot the second one he said already.
Well, can we drop architectures during the lifetime, or is it something just funny?
Technically, yes.
What is the problem with the fact that they would be not in sync? Is it just on the display of...
I think it's mostly on display issue, and some people packages might get uninstallable on the out of sync architectures, though I don't think that's too much of a problem because they are no longer supported anyway.
Can they be removed from the unsupported architectures be completely removed from the suite on?
Probably, yeah, you might also do that instead because it's not you. People then notice that it's no longer supported if it's no longer there. So that might actually be a good idea. What other things? So yeah.
What other risk did you mount?
So if you want a suit without a policy queue, like Squeeze LTS is currently handled, that's fairly simple because you don't need any lock-in or anything. We just drop the current setup of the policy queues and accept uploads directly.
I think even having the option to wait until all the daemon builds and package is nice. So
okay.
So I think keeping a queue makes sense. Moritz, you did not a day to interrupt when you have something to say, but
I would keep it. I mean, the possibility that every DD can upload to it is something really nice, which you shouldn't break, you know, in case it's more complicated gets. I mean, currently for the current architectures, there will be rather fast to build, so I'm not sure how much of a problem is it in practice.
Yeah.
I mean, you always introduce some additional step you should do manually, which people who are not involved in a day-to-day basis will miss. So I'm saying I think 80-90% of all people for that target audience of an LTS release will only exclusively use AMD64. So I don't think that's much a problem. I would keep it as simple as possible. I mean, the more complicated it gets what you want to encourage is to have that the maintainer wants to make the extra effort and still prepares LTS for his own custom package, so that's the ideal case that person does the update himself. The more complicated it gets with any special steps in between, then you lose that or you just introduce regression. So I'm not sure how if there's a specific problem with which arose from how the way it's handled. Right now, I think what we want to get is that the packages are available in the same place so that people don't need to switch their own sources. So
yeah,
technical way.
Definitely.
I wouldn't change the workflow so that maintainers can just upload to the suite and
maybe it's a bit related to the second topic because at least I'm a customer of a hoster which provides ARM CPU, so personally I would like us
can
to
we say the first topic?
Yeah, but just keeping back to the topic, if we add this architecture, then it means one will dim more following LTS and a larger risk of unbuildable package because, well, usually when it builds on IMD64, it builds also on E386, but it might not be the case for ARM architecture. I agree it's probably not needed at the start, and we have this problem often enough, maybe we can continue.
At the moment, I don't know anything that ensures that packages have been so there's no coordination between the uploads and the issuing the DLA. So either the uploader has to go look at the has to monitor those builds before and then send the DLA once the builds are ready. Of course, even that means that it's necessary actually on mirrors. Or they send a DLA before the packages are actually available. With security, there shouldn't be mirrors. I don't know if that's a problem, but there's still gotta wait for those builds to happen. You seem to be saying that's fine.
Clearly, having the queue in front of if we don't want to change that, if we add this queue, then we have to change the time the maintainer can send the DLA. You must wait until we approve it. So you're right that it doesn't impact. Anyway, since Ansgar told us it's easy to drop this queue and have an open policy, let's keep it that way for now and reconsider maybe if we start to have problems with...
Is that GobiDev in all?
Yeah. Both, depth of 15, both LTS.
Can you add to this topic the two benefits we have from this also? Because the benefits are users don't have to change sources list and no delay through mirroring.
Yeah.
And then I would like to ask the security team, this risk of seeing embargo issues is not a risk, it's a real problem. Like anybody at the moment, only the security team can log into Security Master. So how do you think, how do we fix that or address that problem? Can we address that problem?
I'm not sure precisely that needs to be on the FTP server. It's not only the problem of being able, the broader there's an abundance of privilege escalations all the time. So the more people you get with even unprivileged access to Security Master, you always have the risk of, keep this neat and tidy. So
actually, this is no queue to where we have to accept package. Nobody needs to have access.
What?
So.
But there's one other annoying thing currently about Security Master. If you were to use it, that is all mails generated by the archive software are currently redirected to the security team mailing list. It would include that an embargoed upload was accepted and so on. we want to improve on that anyway. But the current state is that only the security team would get mails about any uploads that happen. And also about rejections.
Is there a way around that? Because clearly in the workflow right now, the people upload, they wait, they get their accepted mail, and then they send their DLA.
So the current idea is that mail notifications should also go to the person who signed the upload, so that maintainers that prepare security uploads that are not on the security team notice if something unexpected happens, but that doesn't exist yet. And ideally that the accepted messages for the LTS release should also be sent to the public mailing list, so as it happens now for Squeeze LTS.
So is it?
I mean, it couldn't be just sort of technically in a way that it still gets uploaded to the current suite, which is going to be used, and once all supported architectures, so both 30, so i386 and AD64 are present. It gets sent to the security master through some script.
But that's more complicated. In the end, I think we want to fix the mail handling.
True, that's, yeah, I mean,
it just takes a while.
So, actually, we have nothing to do. It's already part of your plans to mail the person who signed the quotes. Is that correct?
Yes. Because that person should know about the upload anyway.
Yeah.
This also affects like every developer uploads a security update to the archive, and if something's broken, they don't notice, and we have to bounce it manually to them.
Yeah, that,
so that's actually a generic bug. Yeah, I mean, just for that note.
Yeah.
Okay. So, basically, we've solved everything. Or is there something else that might hinder this change? Maybe it's a time or so, we should discuss topic 3 at the same time, because I guess if we want to handle embargoed issues, we will have to use an embargoed queue as well.
Yeah.
And some members of the LTS team will have to have access. And also,
I mean, there's no strict need for an embargoed queue. And it's a separate list, so it's not in our discretion anyway, but I think it can be arranged that one person from the team gets access to the Linux-vendors list. And then that person can prepare the updates, and once they are available, it gets uploaded.
I think it should be 2 or 3 people.
It needs to be limited. We already like more or less maxed out. I mean, if that people is on vacation or whatever, I don't think we can squeeze another 3. We're already pretty at the higher limit. We have the most people of all distributions on the subscribers list, and I mean, we can argue with getting another person due to being some separate project, but we won't be able to get 3 or something like that. We already have more than Red Hat and Susan, for example. So, I don't think so. If some person is unavailable for vacation or whatever, that person is unavailable for vacation or whatever, they can just tell us and we'll bounce things to someone else. But I think we'll be able to get 3.
I didn't want to consider this question directly, but only the parts that would have an impact on the DAC installation. So, who should have access to the security.debian.org machine to. So, you said embargoed queue are not necessary, because the person landing should just upload the thing at the right time, basically. Okay.
But then it'll be delayed if it builds.
Sorry?
Then it's delayed by the minute to five. It has to wait to be built.
Yeah.
That's probably not too long.
Okay. Is there anything else you think we should consider for this?
I don't know, so nothing comes to mind right now.
Let's go to the next topic. We have to go to decide what set of package we're going to support, but also what set of architectures. As I said below, I've got at least one request of customer who were interested in ARM support for long-term support. It was sort of generic query, not so specific to Squeeze. Clearly, it doesn't make sense. So, would it make sense to add support of ARM HF for? And I guess only this one, because ARM really is not the kind of server device that you. I mean, only this ARM architecture is actually using. Several installations, as far as I know.
I don't think it is used in several installations. I don't think ARM, play secret ARM, is used very much in several installations.
I doubt there's a more
Is there the Scalway.com, which is part of online.net, which has a whole cloud infrastructure based on ARM device that they can bring
ARM play stupid.
Sorry?
Play stupid.
It's not the ARM 64. I don't know exactly which processor it is, but it's. I was there, it's really this architecture.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if it makes sense, because if it's only me and I want to contact. Do other people have some experience?
Might make sense for Jesse, maybe, but not for.
So easy,
because I think some of the virtualization stuff is just getting in place now, and all this kind of, so there's lots of stuff missing in ARM, so it's easy.
Yeah, my impression is that ARMHF wasn't that useful in terms of hardware support. It's the kernels didn't support anything terribly useful.
Would I rather ask the question, why not support all architectures?
Does CSA want to get rid of IA64?
Yeah.
Well, I
did not ask DSA what they sort of keeping.
Maybe architectures which are dropped, but in general, I wonder why not supporting them all. There might be some packages which don't build fine, but most security issues are fixed in all, will be fixed in all architectures.
I think. If you keep architectures that are still supported in the later release, it's probably not an issue because we maintain buildies for those anyway, and having them build an extra suit probably doesn't impact it too much.
I think kernel support or kernel updates might be harder.
Right.
These stuff, but in general,
I think it might be nice to support them all.
And there's also the ice rules and ice dust stuff which tends to break when you...
It's not supported in LTS.
No, it's not supported at the moment, but you have that topic.
But there's quite a number of software which is quite brittle. I mean, if you look at the stable proposed update suites where things get stuck for a while, it's almost impossible to get OpenJDK, for example, continuously updated across all suites. It's only supported upstream, essentially for, I think, Spark for historical reasons and for x86, and it breaks all the time. And I don't think this would work out. We haven't had OpenJDK enter a stable point update since 3 years by now, because it's always breaking with some later release. I mean, it would make sense to just look at what are people using and not saying, is this Debian thing that just support everything all the time? But I mean, it comes with a significant cost, and given that the sponsorship which you guys have accumulated is something at the 50% level, I mean, let's spend resources on that which is useful. If there's no demand for running, no one is running Spark on Debian for practical purposes. Have like some toy box somewhere in the basement, and why build all these packages and why deal with regressions and all that?
So, I don't know what's the best way to decide what we want to review, what we want to support in Wizzy in terms of packages. I just dumped here the list of packages that we do not support right now in Squeeze. So
the other way around is there stuff in Squeeze which we would rather not support, so which should maybe move onto this list before we discuss things that are moving out, so which are a constant pain. I don't know of any, it's just because before we pull in stuff, there might be stuff we want to kind of pull out.
Virtual box, for us,
yeah.
Anything with Oracle's not stream.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a valid point, actually, because it's a pain to do.
On the other hand, we have some MySQL people here, which are eager to work with us and keep it.
Can't you just ask the same way you asked for a squeeze, like send an email to at least the supporters and ask them what packages they use?
Oh, I know which package they use. Actually, I can show you that.
Did you send an update for this, for Wheezy?
No, I mean...
I know you sent it for squeeze, but it could have changed for Wheezy.
So this is something I did not publish yet, but that I want to publish. That all the contributors, paid contributors have, it's the list of packages used by, installed by our sponsors. So you can see...
Where are the packages not supported?
Not supported.
How do you count the percentages?
It's basically a proportion of the customers who have this package installed. So Bash is installed everywhere. But there are some cheaters who don't give the list of all installed packages, but only packages they care about. So that's why some packages at least give some idea of which one are popular, which one not popular. I mean, we have quite a long list already of packages which are installed but on several of customers. So I don't know, if you want to check our specific package, we can. We'll go one by one. Do we have people with files?
I don't think anyone uses video wiki on the production side.
You would be surprised by what you can see. anyway, what is more exciting is you have a suggestion, or should we?
That's not a permanent list, though. I mean, this was packages which were assessed at the time when Squeeze LTS was imminent. I mean, if you look at that, third of that packages are removed. And I, for example, I just filed a remove request for another one. So this needs to be checked on the case. There are some which I think are, for example, FFmpeg is not in Wheezy, for example. Drupal 6 is not in Wheezy. Access to C will be, for example, is essentially removed. Several of those haven't made it to Wheezy as well, because they were received RC buggy for a long time and unmaintained. So
okay.
I think there are some packages which will be from OpenStore no longer exist, for example, PDGo has been removed.
Maybe.
There are some which you need to discuss on a generic level, like should there be support for IceWeasel, but for example you won't be able to support Chromium in Wheezy because it's already unsupported in Wheezy, since the newer releases require a more recent version of G++, since it needs some C++11 features which are not available in the toolchain, which is available in Wheezy. So some of them are technically impossible, and for some it's mostly a policy call. Is there demand for IceWeasel and for IceStar, for example? Ice 8, for example, also no longer exists.
Is that basically a question if you want to support any typical desktop applications?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not really involved in LTS, it's just some points I'd like to raise. I mean, what's the focus audience? What are people want to support? And, I mean, supporting IceWeasel is a significant amount of work. Since you need to essentially follow the LTS releases, otherwise there's no way to do it. And my commie won't be able to do that work, so it will be handled as part of the FreeXC and stuff. And if you're doing that, is it in the interest of the people who are paying it? Is there anyone using IceWeasel?
In the case of IceWeasel, we have EDF which is doing the work internally, so the reason why it's not done for Squeeze is just that actually it's similar to Chromium, is that we need Python 2.7 and we don't have that in Squeeze, so it's not built in Squeeze, so they can't deploy the source package that would be built. And on their side they are building it with a sort of PPA which has Python 2.7 for Squeeze. And and then they are just injecting the result of the build in their normal suite. Should we maybe consider something like that as well for us, maybe, at some point?
Is
this is going to be harder, but...
Is it reasonable to add new build tools to the LTS if they're necessary?
Maybe, but...
Well, in the case of Chrome, for example, of Chromium, it would not have been possible because the more recent C++ also has this whole lib-standard C++ and things change, that's not possible. In the case of Python, it would have possible. I mean, you can still change the binary name to make it specific to the IceWeasel build, so with some hacker involved, that would certainly be possible. But no one can really anticipate how IceWeasel will be structured and dealt with it's changing every, I think, essentially like, and the releases are essentially more or less every 6 weeks, and that's, I think the LTS releases, which should be a year, possibly a year?
I think it's every 7 releases.
So every 7, yeah.
Probably 2 weeks.
So essentially roughly a year plus minus something, so no one really knows how IceWeasel 59 will look like, so...
Well, it would be possible to do this in black ports. Yeah, because then you can put the depends in there. Well, and sloppy back ports.
I mean, you might be able to make it work. Raphael guys, I think he's doing the work for EDF, will have. If he has been able to do this by now, probably works out, but I think you can't make promises for that, but...
Mm. Well, does anyone really need desktop applications for LTS?
For researchers, Linux desktop for researchers, so that's actually a desktop thing.
There's the other desktop users as well. Which is the same, also schools often have that. And okay.
So, looks like we.
And 37% of the paying customers have high school.
Oh,
okay.
So are we planning to support some form of virtualization stack?
Yeah, that was my next question, because maybe we don't want to check each package individually, but clearly KVM, Xen, and QEMU were packages that are installed on installed on use makers and sponsored, and it's an important use case. I know they tend to be affected by quite a lot of issues that where they don't see use work, but do you see any issue apart from the amount of work or it for the Xen and KVM?
For Squeeze, the decision was because that time both LibVM, for example, and QEMU were at really early stages, so it wouldn't have. And even if you would throw a solid full-time position on that, you wouldn't have been able to backport all this, because you would need to essentially backport huge parts of functionality which are missing for various kinds of security fixes. I'm not sure about 1.1.12, which is for QEMU in VV. I'm not sure. Maybe check with Michael Kukarev, who's the maintainer. Should probably, I mean, it will probably work out, but it also depends on the level of familiarity with those people who are familiar with QEMU, willing to you will get run into some complicated backports, that's for sure, because a lot of these security fixes are actually intrusive, so the older it gets, the more complicated it gets. For Xen, it's probably easier because the Xen upstream support dates back quite long. I mean, they still support, I think, the last three and a half years, so it's not that bad. But with QEMU, I think you're on your own for much, much earlier.
Yeah.
Because they don't have that kind of long-term support service.
And is that the kind of package where we can do like with Wireshark and import a new upstream version, or is that out of question? I don't know.
So if you would do that with QEMU, you would very likely at least have to fix Libvir from time to time, because new features on new QEMU sometimes breaks all the Libvir.
Okay.
So yeah, at least have these two packages entangled in some way. I think it's doable, but it's just not that we can just only use it.
Okay.
And there might be like other things like CBIOS and these kind of things which need updates as well. But I think for the virtualization part, it would actually be really nice to have this kind of stuff. So it might be worth the effort.
Yeah, right.
Maybe we can have a kind of check what Rapid Enterprise Linux currently supports or something like that, and maybe kind of look if this maybe is by accident some kind of version we're quite close to, because then this would save some work.
Agree on this wording or something like that. Does it make sense to people? But we should aim to support virtualization related packages, even if it's the cost of upgrading to a new version. This is something that we can do not only for those batch, but more. It might be forced, like for MySQL.
I'm not sure if that is too specific or too general.
Yeah.
Because we should.
But
and which virtualization technology and.
Well, those which are not supported right now. Those on the list here.
Yeah.
Oh. let's say, the obligation to not exclude.
I'm not sure if the way of supporting the basic NXC and VZ is useful. Libvirt, I think it is, but LXC, I don't think so.
Is LXC actually a package that is coding regular security support issue? Do you remember, Maurice?
Well, if there were anything, it's mostly... There were a few, but I think it's not even... Is it in VZ actually? I'm not sure.
It's in VZ.
Would it be useful in VZ?
No.
More than security issue?
Would it be useful without a new kernel?
Yeah, exactly.
Most of that would be
useful. Well, if it's not usable, then it's not usable. Okay, we don't have many minutes left. On the topic of embargoed issue, we had some discussion on the mailing list already a few months ago. Moritz, again you, sorry, from the security team. Do you agree with the idea of creating an alias for two or three people from the NTS team, where you or anyone that would be designated to follow the training embargo list would forward the relevant information so that...
No, I think we can just decouple it and just find one person who can get subscribed to Linux-vendors and then that person can handle it.
Yeah.
And if that person is on vacation or whatever, then we can step in for a few weeks, but we don't want to get entangled in that.
So you'd rather not have the security team forward data to these alias, and you prefer that someone is directly appointed on this list, I guess?
There are no aliases allowed on the special vendors for the...
Yeah, sure.
They don't want that.
But you also want to forward that info.
Well, I guess...
Yeah, but the idea of it is that you're not forwarding what is sent there. I mean, that's
not automatically,
premise.
But...
Yeah, but not even, I mean, if there's no boilerplate. I mean, if we just find someone and...
Then he must do the work.
What?
Then he must do the work himself. He should not share the data with...
Yeah, but you can't subscribe in a lie, so you just find one person, and we can just check who people was appropriate and... Then we can recommend that person gets added to Linux Dash vendors, and then he can forward at his discretion. Some of the information sent there is explicitly not allowed to be forwarded, for example. So in that case, that person would need to do the work himself and upload it in place. But what are you referring to that? Is it the access to the Linux-vendor list, or what does...
Well, in my idea was that we would not add someone from the NTS team directly to the Linux-vendor list, but...
Okay,
so you want
to create a contact point if we just want to forward something?
Yes. To us.
We can certainly do that, but I was referring to get access to the Linux Bash vendors list, because that would not be possible with such a setup.
Yeah,
yeah, you sure you can do that. I mean, and then we can forward whatever, or we can just add them to CC. Sure, to do that.
Would that be enough, or do you still want someone from the NTS team to join Linux vendors?
I think it would still be useful. So, because that person should ideally also participate in the discussions on that mailing list. So if there's something, for example, there's from time to time there's discussion like, does someone still use that version? So in that case, that person could step forward and say, yeah, this is actually still supported, without the other subscribers being...
Okay.
And you could also, I mean, for example, if that person is on that mailing list, he would also know to the others, for example, say, for example, in case there's the patch for the squeeze version is more complicated than for stable or for Wheezy or for Jesse, and then that person could check up with the person who reported it, how to backport it, etc., etc. So there might be just cases where a longer discussion evolves around that, and in that case, it would be totally bad if someone totally unrelated to this whole mailing list just pops up and they hike up this information. And
okay.
So let's rather make this official and clean and find a person who would be appropriate and get him.
Okay. Is the alias on this domain managed directly by the security team?
Yes, they does it. We used it in the past, but then they streamlined it with the other mail handling nodes in DSA.
So we should just open it again?
Yeah, just CC on us and to do it.
Yeah, okay. I guess we have under the most important question, and this question we can do it off video or in the room and on the order while on the list. Are we happy with the result? Roughly? Okay. So thank you for participating. Enjoy the rest of your conference.